on. Crazy Phase is always on. What's happening? The water's going up and down. It's changing the pitch of the standing wave pattern, actually. Well, not the pitch, actually. It's actually changing a little bit about that. But it's changing the height of this, and it's changing where I hear the, where I cut into the standing wave pattern. Remember how we had the springs on the floor? We had the empty note, and I said, well, if I put my foot here, it's really going to hurt. If I put it here, I won't even feel it. Or if I put my ear here, I'm going to hear a lot right in the middle of the empty note. And it also was changing the pitch, but we're not going to worry about pitch today. We're going to worry about cutting into that standing wave pattern. So, if here's my tube, and here's my water level, if I have a standing wave, let's say I have a tuning fork, and we know it's a compression wave, but I'm going to model it as a transverse wave. Let's say it comes in, and it hits. It's a fixed end reflection, so it's going to reflect back 180 degrees. And if this is my ear or microphone, I'm cutting right into one of these antinodes. I'm almost cutting right in with a full wavelength. I'm actually at, here's the whole one, I'm cutting in at half, 3/4 of a wavelength. And so it's vibrating very, very quickly here. The medium being what? Water or air? Yeah, exactly. The medium being the air. If I move this water up, then it's going to do this. And I'll cut in at the node, and I will hear what? I will hear nothing. I will hear nothing. Because if I'm cutting in at the node, no vibration's happening there. Okay, very, very low pressure. Because it's a standing wave. They're adding together. In this case, they're adding together positively. But where the cutoff point is, where the lip of that tube is, it's at the node. I'm not going to hear anything. So what should happen is, if I create a standing wave pattern, not with anything like that, but with, instead of tuning fork, I should actually be able to find points where I can, oh, hear that? Come on back up. Very, very loud. That's where I'm cutting into an antinode. And these are pretty long wavelengths. I cut into it again. Pretty long wavelength, so when I'm between two antinodes, that's only half of a wavelength. So between here and here is just half of the wavelength. Just like the distance between a node and a node is half of a wavelength. So what I can do is, knowing what the speed of sound is in this air, let's say it's 343 meters per second, I can actually figure out what the wavelength is and then figure out what the frequency is of this tuning fork. Or I could go in reverse. I could read the frequency off of this and figure out what the wavelength should be and see if it makes any sense. So what we're going to do is actually mark off as close as we can those two points. Harrison, you want to be in this picture? Why does the water go up and down as I move this cup? So the water, this is the original level. So I could end up with water at one point and I say, I want you to build a brick wall that's level. So what do you need to do? You need to get a big pool of water, or maybe even just tubes of water, and you hold one at one end, hold one at the other, and they will always equalize. Because the pressures have to be the same. It's based on gravity. You're watching this, you didn't warn me. I see these eyes go. Right, they have to equalize. Where's the water going? Where's it going? It's filling up my cup. It should go down to this level. Now, if I have enough volume in this cup, it won't overflow. If I don't, it's going to spill over. But water is always seeking that even level, any fluid is. So, let's mark off. You just run the cup. You run the cup. We're going to start right at the top. I might have to hit it a couple times because it'll lose its vibration. Okay, that's good. Notice that it speeds up faster if he has a greater difference. So it's kind of. Okay, move down. I'm thinking right there, what do you think? Okay, keep going. Was it right there?
Yeah.
Okay. And we could try to go down and find another one because it looks like we could actually fit the whole wavelength in here, couldn't we? But in fact, let's do it. We have enough. Right there. Okay, very good, thank you. Now just hold that for the rest of the day. So my first curiosity is, are these antinode sections, are they actually the same length? Some human error involved, right? Let's see. I'm looking at about 34 centimeters. This one I'm hoping is about 34 centimeters. Approximately. I'm going to average them out. I'm going to say 33. It's like 32 and a half. I'm going to say 33. Again, based on some delay, my perspective, thickness of the marker, those kind of things. So we're looking at a 33-centimeter antinode. And once you collect that data, 33 centimeters, or 0.33 meters, that means, get rid of the green, 0.33 meters, is a length of half of a wave. What's my whole wavelength? 0.66, right? Lambda equals 0.66 meters. So the wavelength of sound produced by that tuning fork is this long. So imagine that. You strike it, and you're literally making waves this long in space. Let's see, where'd it go? 512 hertz, the key of C. The waves that you're feeling from me are this long, and it's going to take a different number of waves to get to each person. So let's see if that holds true. We're going to test this tuning fork and see if it's actually 512 hertz. We're going to do it by assuming it is, and assuming the speed of sound is what? 340 or 343 approximately meters per second. Say the frequency was, what did I say it was, 512? 512 hertz, which is an inverse second. What am I going to use? Well, first, what am I looking for? Lambda, lambda, lambda. I'm looking for a wavelength. So, what am I going to use? Do I hear this? The wave speed, wavelength times frequency. Wavelength is the wave speed Over the frequency, absolutely.
Assuming that the speed of sound really is this, at this temperature and humidity, assuming the tuning fork is accurate, 343 over 512, seconds are gone. What is that? What's 343 over 512? I'm feeling good, because I know that 3 over 5 is 0.6. I'm feeling really good here. Are you serious? You're not just saying that to make me feel happy? 0.66. Should have used this tuning fork. 0.66 meters, right? That's all that's left. So the tuning fork's accurate, the speed of sound is accurate, or they're off by the same amount. That's okay too. So, what have we done in this abbreviated lab? We've understood how changing water affects the length of that tube. We understand about the standing wave pattern, where it reflects back at 180 degrees and adds together with itself. The incident sound wave and the reflected sound wave forms that standing wave pattern. We've cut into the node wherever we could, and we've done the calculations for the wavelength. We figured everything out, and we verified that actually it does make sense, these different lengths. So what questions do you have for this?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
When the wavelength hits the bottom of the water,
mm-hmm.
why doesn't some of that sound kind of go through the water?
Spoken like a true sonographer. Yes. Absolutely. When you reach that medium, some is transmitted through and some is reflected back. So you're absolutely right. We're missing a percentage of this. And if you remember back on that animation from the website with the blue background you couldn't really see very well, if we had a thin string and then a thick string and they were tied together, when we put a wave pulse here, some was reflected back and some continued on. Perfect question. I've never had it, but I was hoping someone would ask it eventually. So very good. Anything else? So you know what you would do to write this up? You would just go through and describe the process, do the the calculations are done, but you'd record those calculations.
That's another Dave LaFazia production.